in the series, when I started this series, I hadn't planned on doing as long a series on being a part of the family of God. But as I got into it, there was more and more and more and more that I could talk about, and thought maybe we should explore and unpack this idea of being a part of the family of God a little bit more. And so we're going to do that today. I'm going to review a little bit, and then we'll pick up on some new material. The verse that will be in the next slide for you is one of the key verses in John 1, 12 through 13. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to be the children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. That's the idea. When we believe and receive, we are born again, born of God into the family of God. In Romans 8, 13 through 17, it says, "For if you live according to the sinful nature, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live." Okay? "Because those who are led by the Spirit are the sons of God." Are the sons of God. "For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the spirit of sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father," which is close personal relationship with the Father. "The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." See, we're part of God's family, and I'm so glad to be part of God's family. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. And that simply means that all of the glories of heaven, as Jesus will inherit all of those glories because of his suffering and sacrifice, we will inherit those glories as well. As he lives in heaven for eternity, we will live in heaven for eternity. As he rules, we will rule under him. We will never be God. We are not gods waiting to happen. We will never be God, even when we're in heaven. We will be created beings. There's only one God, and we're not it, okay? But we will share in those blessings. And then I want to go a little further with this next verse in Ephesians 2, 18 through 20. Now watch the wording here and watch the terminology that's used. "For through him we both have access to the" what? "The Father." You see, family relationship. How is that possible? "By one Spirit." By one Spirit. Consequently, well, let me touch on this. Right in this we have the Trinity. Okay? Through him, who's the him? Jesus. We have access to the Father by the see? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Each part of the Trinity is a part of our salvation. So because through him we have access to the Father, consequently, so because that's true, here's what happens. We're no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people. And who were God's people? The Israelites in the Old Testament. Fellow citizens with them, even though we might not have been born Jewish, we're now fellow citizens with them and members of God's what? Household. Members of God's family. That's the church. See, the church is this, that God takes the national Jews and Gentiles and he puts us all together, that it doesn't matter anymore. Galatians says that we are neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female. The only thing that matters is our relationship to the Father through Jesus Christ the Son. We're part of the same family because of that. We're members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. So the Bible, the apostles and the prophets Old Testament, the apostles New Testament, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. So let's look at what it says. We're no longer strangers. A stranger is someone that's an outsider, is a person who does not belong. I was talking to someone that's going to be coming and speaking in the church in a few weeks, and he said, well, is there a contact person or who should I contact when I get there? And I said, well, what we like to do when we see someone we don't know, we like to point at them and yell, stranger, stranger. It doesn't much help for church growth. Visitor, we like to make our visitors feel welcome. Stranger, stranger. But what does that mean? A stranger is someone that is outside of who we know. Okay? Now, watch. Apart from Jesus Christ, we're on the outside of God's household. Because we've chosen to live our own lives, live in rebellion, reject Jesus' sacrifice. We want to do what we want to do, when we want to do it, and we don't want to listen to God or anybody else. So we're strangers. We're on the outside. A stranger is the person that doesn't belong. Okay? But in the house, well, let me keep going. The foreigner is someone that's born outside of that nation, a sojourner, someone that's, in a sense, wandering. In this context, it would be someone that was not born a Jew, that was part of God's people. All of us were outside of God and his kingdom. We were all born into sin, chose to sin at the earliest possible age. We were unknown to God and his kingdom. We did not belong to God and his kingdom until Jesus Christ. But through Jesus Christ and our belief in him and receiving his work, what happens when we believe and receive? He makes us the children of God. That now God is our Father. Jesus is our brother. We're joint heirs with Jesus. We're empowered by the Holy Spirit. We're no longer strangers and foreigners. But verse 18, but through Jesus, we have access to the Father. Through Jesus, we are part of God's household. Now, what does that mean for us today? If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then you're part of the family of God. You're part of the universal family of God that it might incorporate billions of people, but you're also part of the local family of God, which would be Malaga Assembly of God, or if you're visiting from another church, whatever your local church is. Because of Jesus, we're not outsiders looking in. We're not strangers, although some of us might still be strange, and I include myself in that category. But because of Jesus, we are part of the family of God. Here we are. We're different people. We come from different places. Now, how many were born outside of the United States? Okay, where? Germany? Malaysia? Poland, welcome today. Brother, in Italy, Germany, guy was born in Naples, Italy. Who would have thought, however many years later, I'll leave that go, who would have thought, though, that we would all be here? Even me, I was born in Ohio. I'd never heard of Malaga, okay? I had never really even heard of Malaga, Spain. I never heard of Malaga, Spain until I came to Malaga, New Jersey. Or as people on the phone, telemarketers like to say, Malaga. Do you ever get that? Do you ever get that? Malaga. Are you still from Malaga? No, I'm not actually. But anyway, now I was born in Ohio. How about some other states that you were born in? New York. Minnesota. West Virginia. We have a few West Virginians here. Thanks for wearing shoes today. Appreciate it. Come on now. Man, I couldn't wait to say that. You don't know how excited that makes me. Okay, who else over here? I'm sorry. Susan? We're at New York? Oh, in Syracuse. Okay, upstate. Nick was born in the Bronx, New York. Adam? Philadelphia? Robbie? In Florida. I didn't realize that. Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania. That's where you were born? I did not know that. Nathan? North Carolina? God bless you. Brooklyn, New York. Come on. Anybody else? Yeah, Joyce? California. Ed? Baltimore, Maryland. Yes. Johns Hopkins, right? Somebody else. Ardella? Shippensburg, Pennsylvania. Yep, Jim. Hazleton. But he also, I saw another hand back there. Yep. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I sense something. I sense the, we're two agree, touching anything on earth. Yeah, John? North Jersey. Amen. It is different. No. That is different. Yes. There's a line there somewhere, and it is totally different. Totally different. Yeah, Dory was born in North Jersey, too, in New Brunswick, years ago, that we're going to celebrate after the service with cake. But yeah, actually, Dory's father, Joseph David, who our Joseph's named after, was born at St. Peter's in New Brunswick. Dory was born in St. Peter's, and Joseph was born at St. Peter's. So Joseph settled in New Brunswick and, you know, keep it going. But anyway, so watch this, though. No, watch. Think about it. We know it from other countries, from other states. That makes us different. But here we are together from different families, natural families. Here we are together in one place. And so what makes us the same? Our relationship to Jesus Christ. Because what happens is, through Jesus Christ, although we might have been strangers and born in different places and at different times and different parents, earthly parents and everything, when we accept Jesus Christ, we become part of the family of God. And so watch this. Now this is a little tough, but we in some ways are more closely related because of Jesus than we are to some of our family members born through natural blood. Jesus becomes that uniter. He's the one that brings us together. He's the one that brings us to the Father. And so wherever we come from, we have the same Father. The same Father. Can I give you good news today? That no matter what your childhood was like, whether it was good or whether it was terrible, and I know some of you came from very, very difficult backgrounds, when you accept Jesus, God the Father becomes your heavenly Father, and he loves you and cares for you like no other human can. And he accepts you. Now watch what he does. I'll just say this in general terms. He looks at the mess that we are apart from Jesus, and some of it environmental, some of it our own choices. He looks at the mess that we are, and he says, I still choose you to be part of my family. And we look at ourselves and say, why would anybody choose us? But God Almighty looks down and he chooses you to be part of his family. And we respond by saying, yes, God, I want to be part of your family. Can I be part of your family? He says, absolutely. Is there room for me? Oh, there's room for everyone. There's room for everyone. That's the family of God. Different places, different backgrounds, different age categories, different socioeconomic status, different in a lot of ways, but similar because of Jesus Christ. He brings us together. And so here we are. We're the same through Jesus Christ. And so now we're looking at, because we're part of the household of God, and all the rest of the sermon will be on this, here are the privileges that we have of being a part of the family of God. And I use the word privileges because I'm relating it to family, but it's actually the promises of God. But we have privileges for being part of the family of God. Next week we're going to look at the responsibilities. Responsibilities of being part of the family, but today is the privileges we have of being part of the family of God. Now God has given us so much. Imagine an earthly child that has a beautiful home and a beautiful bedroom and clothes and food and everything that they could possibly need, but a child choosing to live in the yard instead of in the house. You would look at that child and say, what are you doing? You're missing all of the blessings of being part of the household. And the child says, that's okay. I don't want to do that, this and that, and the other thing. I'd rather live as an outsider. I'd rather live as a stranger than I would live as part of the family and the privileges and the joys of being part of that family. Do you know some people live their lives like that? Just got texted again while I was preaching. Some people live their lives like that. They call themselves part of the family of God, but they don't want to follow the Father. And so in actuality, instead of enjoying all of the blessings that God gives us, they're living out in the front yard. Come in. Come in. God has great things, wonderful things for you. And even when we look at the responsibilities, none of them are terrible. All of them just bring more blessings. When we will fulfill the responsibilities of family, we have more blessings. So we'll look at that next week. Imagine a child refusing to eat at the table that the parents provided. Instead, they would rather go outside and eat a cold can of Chef Boyardee. I mean, I can't imagine that. But why would you give up the blessings of homemade food and go outside and ever eat, ever in the history of your life, ever eat Chef Boyardee? But some people live their life with God. They live on the outside, although they're welcome. They're welcome in the house. Come in, come in, come in. They refuse to. Well, let's look at some of the blessings. And I have scriptures for all of them. You won't have time to turn there. If you're interested in them, please let me know. I'll be happy to give them to you. But the first privilege and promise that we have from God is that God the Father will love us unconditionally with no strings attached. He knows the mess we are. He welcomes us into his family, and then gradually he turns us into his masterpiece because of his love for us. 1 John 3:1, see how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children. And that is what we are, exclamation point. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that. We are God's children because they don't know him. But see how much the Father loves us? He calls us his children. We haven't earned that right. We don't deserve it, but he chooses us. He cares for us. Scripture says, cast all your cares on him, for he what? Cares for you. That's the privilege of being part of the family of God. For those outside of the family, watch, God cares for them, but they're not in the family, and so they don't receive the full blessings that we receive. They receive what we would call theologically common grace. Common grace is air to breathe. Common grace is trees and beauty. Common grace is, you know, water and all of that. Every human receives those things. But not every human is part of the family of God, because the only way we are part of the family of God is through Jesus Christ. And so there are special blessings, special promises, special privileges reserved just for family members. He takes interest in us. Keep me as the apple of your eye, the psalmist says. Hide me in the shadow of your wings in Psalm 17:8. He provides food and clothing and everything that we need in Matthew 6:31 through 34. Do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things. And your heavenly Father, see, your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then all these things will be added unto you. You don't have to worry about the basic provisions of life if you seek God first. I like this verse. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. I need that verse. And I like it. Do not worry about tomorrow. I have been, when I wake up now in the middle of the night and my mind starts to wander, here's something, maybe this will be helpful to you. I'll look at my clock and I'll say, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. There's nothing I can do about it right now. You know what? There's nothing I can do about it right now. And then go back to sleep. Haven't we all woken up in the middle of the night with burdens and concerns? Turn that into reflecting on Jesus. Turn your mind towards, there's 2 o'clock in the morning, there's nothing I can do about it now. God, will you help me tomorrow? And God says, my mercies are new every day. Great is my faithfulness. I'll be there. Whatever you need tomorrow, I'll provide that as well. Anyway, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And all God's people said, amen. He disciplines those he loves. Now, watch this. I'm going to have to do a whole nother series, but not today, on the discipline of the Lord. God will never punish you. He will never punish you if you are a member of his household. Punishment was received by our brother Jesus on the cross. So us as his children will never be punished. Those that reject Jesus and stand before him on judgment day, they will receive punishment. God is never, ever against you, ever. When you accept Christ, he is always for you. And so if you're going through a difficult time, he's not punishing you because he's against you. He will help you and discipline you, meaning to live more like him, to shave off some areas that shouldn't be there. And he does that through trials, troubles, and tears sometimes. He'll discipline you, but he'll do that because he loves you. Through Jesus, God will never stop loving you, and he will never punish you. And so don't think, and I'll just use this as an example, that you went to the doctor and got a bad report from the doctor, God is punishing me for something that I did. That's not God. God will love you through that bad report. God will be there with you through that bad report. God will use that bad report to strengthen your faith, to grow in your relationship to him. He'll discipline you like training, like discipline training to make us better and stronger. But God will never punish you because Jesus took the punishment on the cross so that I don't have to take that punishment. And all God's people said, amen. He disciplines us. I got to keep going. You are, he addresses us as sons, do not make light of the Lord's discipline. Do not lose heart when he disciplines you. The Lord disciplines those he loves. As parents, we discipline our children because we love them. We want them to live rightly. Okay, provision. God will provide for all of our needs. And my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches in glory. Isn't that good news? That's a privilege. That's a promise of being part of the family. He will protect us and shelter us. In Psalm 91, 1 and 2, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my strength, my God in whom I trust. He will protect you. He will shelter you. When you're under attack, God will protect you against the enemy. Listen, the enemy, the devil, the enemy of our souls will never go beyond what God allows to happen. And God will never allow you to be destroyed, when you run to him for shelter. He gives direction to us. Those in the family, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Because we're part of the family. You know this as parents and grand. You would do anything for your children. How much more does God Almighty love us? He'll lead us and guide us if we'll follow him. He'll prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. He'll anoint our heads with oil to the point that our cup will overflow. His goodness and mercy will follow us all of the days of our life on earth, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And forever. Why? Because we're part of the family. Fellowship. 1 Corinthians 1:9. God, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, he is faithful. He's called us into fellowship with his Son. When can we talk to Jesus? Anytime. Doesn't just have to be on Sunday morning in church. It could be at home, it could be in our car, it could be at work, it could be in our private time. We have fellowship with Jesus. We would say, you ask the question, you know, who would you like to have dinner with in history? And we would say, Jesus. Do you know, you can spend time with Jesus now. Revelation, I forget what verse says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Right? And then what do? Do you know that verse? If you open, and he will come in and what? Sup, my King James people. That's how I learned it too. And that means he'll have fellowship with us if we just open that door to him. Lord Jesus, I need you. Sometimes that's the best prayer possible. We can have fellowship with him. Let me keep going. We have companionship, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. Watch, as part of the family of God, you're never alone because God the Holy Spirit is with you because Jesus sent him, and Jesus says it's true. He'll send another helper. Just because Jesus left earth physically doesn't mean he left us all alone. He's still with us. We have companionship with him. We have intimacy with the Father. And this is the last one. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. We can know God because we can go to God ourselves. You don't need anyone else to go to God on your behalf. If you're a child, you can go to God. If you're a child of his, you can go right to the Father. You don't need anyone else to go there for you. You can have a personal relationship with him. You can go right into the throne room, right into his meeting place, and you'll receive the mercy and the grace that you need. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I'll close with this. I've been in church my whole life, 49 years, never left the church. First baby born into the new sanctuary in September of 1966. I've never, ever been outside of the church realm. When I was in Bible school, I've probably attended church the least that I did my whole life just because of other things and responsibilities, but I never fell away from the Lord. Then when I got out of Bible school, I was in ministry since I was 21 years old. I've been in the church my whole life. And with being in the church and my parents being involved in church, I've had every opportunity to leave the church because I've seen the good, the bad, and the ugly, and I've been at the receiving end of the good, the bad, and the ugly. But I've never left God's church or God's family because I didn't look to other people to meet my needs. I looked to the Father to meet my needs, and the Father always meets my needs. And so I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. And I don't mean this in a bad way. I'm glad we're all part of it together, but I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God, not because of each of you, but because of the Father. That's what unites us and brings us together. It's a wonderful relationship we have, and I don't mean that negative. I'm thankful for all of you. You know that. But it's because of him. Keep your eyes on the Father. Receive the blessings. Don't live out in the yard when God has so much more in store for you as a part of the family of God. And all God's people said, amen. Let's stand together.